Let's look at an example using real data that involves group and pivot and join. We're going to look at a data set that was released publicly about a bike sharing system that was installed in the San Francisco Bay Area. In this bike sharing system, the public bikes are locked into these bike racks, and then you can subscribe to use them. When you arrive, you enter your subscription ID, and one of the bikes unlocks. You can ride it to any of the other public bike racks around the city and then lock it up. And these are designed for commuters. So they can, for example, take a train into the city and then borrow a bike to bike wherever they need to go, which is probably not the train station. Now, this was a pilot program. People were interested to see how much the bikes would get used and where people used them. And instead of analyzing that information themselves, the organization that put together this bike sharing service just released it publicly and asked the community of data scientists around the SF Bay Area to take a look and see what they could find. And we'll do exactly that as well. So there are multiple tables involved in this data set. One of them describes each of the bike trips. It's called trip. It takes a moment to load because it's got all these columns, so each trip has an ID, that doesn't tell us anything. But the duration sure does. This is the number of seconds between when the bike was checked out and when it was returned. And here's the moment that it was checked out. The start station describes where, in this case the Ferry Building in San Francisco, the bike was borrowed. This is where in the bike rack it was. 765 seconds later, it's now 2339, and the bike was returned to the San Francisco Caltrain station. That's a train station that allows people to take the train into other cities in the San Francisco Bay Area. Where in the bike rack they put it, which bike was ridden, and a little bit of information about the person who borrowed the bike. You can either subscribe to use bikes as much as you want, or you can rent them by the hour. And this is a year's worth of data. And how many bike trips were there? Well, there were these 10 plus another 345,142 bike trips. Well, that's a lot. Let's draw a histogram of the duration of different bike trips. That is a one boring looking histogram. We've got some bar here, we've got some huge numbers here. Let's see what's going on. If I sort this table by duration, I can see which are the longest trips. And the reason the histogram looks so weird is that there are a handful of trips that appear to be really long. This one has a lot of seconds. So if we try to turn that into minutes, turn it into hours, turn it into days, we see this bike was checked out for 200 days. This bike was stolen and then somehow recovered 200 days later. It was checked back into one of the bike racks. We're not interested in trips like that. That's not like a bike trip. That's just someone taking a bike for 200 days. What we are interested in is the standard way in which these were used is that you could subscribe and use bikes as much as you want, as long as your trips didn't last more than half an hour. So let's call those the commutes. That's when you have a trip and the duration of your trip are below 1800 seconds. That's 30 minutes. So here's the same table, fewer rows, but still most of the rows are here. 338,000 instead of the 354,000 we had before. So we have the vast majority of the trips still included in our data set, but we don't have any weirdly long durations. So let's try again to draw a histogram of the duration. Oh, that looks like a more reasonable histogram. Let's have 60 bins and let's label our units. And what is the unit? Well, that's what duration is measured in. In this case, it's measured in seconds. So a commute trip could be 0 seconds, it could be 30 minutes or 1800 seconds, anything in between. We see most of them are kind of in the range of 200 to 800, maybe 1,000 seconds. 1,200 seconds, that's 20 minutes. So most things are in the range of like 3 to 20 minutes, with some of them longer. But remember, it's free for commuters as long as they don't hit 1,800. So they're really quite motivated to turn in their bike before then. And instead of just turning it in right before 30 minutes expires, they go where they need to go and then they lock up their bike. So we went and found some data that described how people really behaved in the world, and we got this curve. It's not any sort of perfect bell curve or anything like that. It has its own unique and interesting shape, and that's very common in real-world data sets. That if you just take some column, which is full of observations, and you plot it, you'll get some interesting shape. And let's quickly try to understand what's going on the vertical axis. This is percent per second. So if I took some range, like here I go from 250 to about 550, and everything in here is more or less 0.15, some is a little bit lower, some is a little bit higher. It should be the case that the area of all these bars together gives me some fraction of the whole. So if I take the width, that would be 550 minus 250. I'll take the height, which is about 0.15%. Now I'll get the percentage of the total, that is between 250 and 550 seconds, is about 45%. So something like a little bit less than half of all the trips are in this range right here. And then the other half, well, you have this long tail to the right, and then you do have a bunch of them that are less than 250 seconds that are like right here in this range. Okay, so we looked at the distribution of different durations. Let's look at where people were when they started. So if I take the starts, those are everything in the commute table, but I'm gonna group by start station. And then to find the most popular start stations, I'll sort by their count, with descending equal to true, so that the most common start stations appear at the top. This does take a moment because there were so many different rows in the first place, but it's done now, and we can see that San Francisco Caltrain is the most common place to start a bike trip, followed by San Francisco Caltrain 2. There are actually two bike racks next to each other because it's such a popular starting location. Then the ferry building is where the ferries come into San Francisco. The Transbay Terminal is where buses come into San Francisco. And these are all places where you could grab a bike and then bike somewhere else. So group is useful in telling us where people start. What about where they go? Well, now we need to know where they start and where they end. A convenient way to display that information is to pivot. Start station goes on the columns, end station goes in the rows, and then we'll just count up how many trips start in a particular place and end in some other place. So here we see for all the trips that started at Broadway Street and Battery Street, an intersection in San Francisco, 21 of them ended at 2nd and Folsom, 350 of them ended at 2nd and Townsend, 600 of them ended at Beale and Market, and we have a pretty interesting view about where people go when they borrow a bike in San Francisco. Now some of these are zero. Nobody biked from Broadway and Battery to Adobe on Almaden. Turns out that's because this is in a completely different city. This is in San Francisco, this is down in San Jose, maybe 50 miles away. It would be a really long bike trip to be able to do that. And remember, we're limited to only 30 minutes. So this would be some extreme cyclist that was able to do that. So instead, we see zeros here because you don't bike from the San Francisco to San Jose. You just use the train instead, of course. And that explains the zeros and one of the structural patterns that appears in this data set.